Let's find out what Molly's seen.
Well, I must say, it's great to be home, and I've got to admit that I've unashamedly fallen in love with two albums, and it absolutely confirms my belief that the British and the Irish almost have an edge over any other group in the world. The first of the albums is The Joshua Tree by U2, and what a superb album this is. It certainly is the strongest album to come out of U2. The lyrics are very, very strong. One song, which is my favourite, Bullet the Blue Sky, will turn out, I'm sure, to be a classic. But not only that, the production is just something else. Produced by Brian Eno and Daniel Lanois, and three of the tracks remixed by the master of mixing for rock and roll, Steve Lillywhite. With all those talents together, the U2 fans are going to be more than happy about this album. And what's more, I think it's going to attract a lot of new U2 fans. The single Out, With or Without You, is zooming up the charts, and watch out for this one as well. The Joshua Tree, it's going to be a huge album. And the second album is, this is a complete surprise. I loved their first, but they have really, really mastered the second, and this is Simply Red with Men and Women. It's, again, a great album. I can't rave enough about it. My particular favourite on this particular album is Love Fire. It's a very reggae number. The Right Thing, which you saw earlier in the show, in fact, that kicked off the show today, that's a superb number. But this is just a bag full of goodies. Mick Hucknall, in fact, co-writes two of the songs, Infidelity and Suffer, with a legendary songwriter in Lamont Dozier, who was one of the masters of Tamla Motown and wrote some of the classics for Tamla Motown. So all in all, you're going to love this particular album. It was produced by Alex Sadkin, and ironically enough, I caught up with Alex Sadkin in London because he was in the Rack Studios producing Boom Crash Opera. And in fact, I also caught up with the boys, and this is what they had to say about working with Alex and how their forthcoming album is going.
Great. Mr. Alex Sadkin, the producer, is Marvin's pants person to work with, and the album's going to be fantastic.
We seem to have more songs than we can shake a stick at.
Because we're not at home, we're not distracted with, you know, friends, etc. So our minds are all focused at the one project.
Right.
Making a record.
And you sort of forget your peers. Like in Australia, you tend to think of other Australian bands, and over here, you get an international sort of perspective, and you forget about that. And you get a lot of new influences as well.
Okay, Boom Crash Opera in the studios in London. Talking about London, there's been a lot of fun on the charts over there at the moment. Boy George is number one, and at number four is Freddie Mercury, and he's done, would you believe, a cover version of an old song called Great Pretender. I never thought anyone would do that. He's done one, and it is a great tongue-in-cheek look at both Queen and himself. So here it is, a sneak preview, out soon, Great Pretender, Freddie Mercury.
Oh, yes, I'm the great pretender.
Okay, well, there it is, Freddie Mercury in his element, and watch out for that because that'll be on the show in the next couple of weeks. Also coming up on the show in the next couple of weeks is a big announcement for a competition, and that's something you can't miss out on. But on next week's show, we catch up with Billy Idol on the set of Don't Need a Gun. We also have a talk to Roland Giff from Fine Young Cannibals, and we have an exclusive interview with Bon Jovi, because I tell you what, over in America, it's like Beatlemania over there. All right, whilst I was in London, I caught up with Boy George, and we had a very honest chat about his past and his present.
I own just to have you back again, just to hold you once again. If there's someone you know that won't let you go, and taking it all for granted, losing one day, someone take.
I went for a very self-destructive phase, and I also got, you know, very confused with what I was doing musically, and, you know, my career, everything was going wrong, and, you know, people were like throwing insults at us, and I just couldn't deal with it, you know. And I think the worst thing was going to New York, really, because that, you know, that's the sort of place, that's a land of excess, you know, and I went there and sort of got carried away with it all, really. I just forgot about Culture Club, forgot about being Boy George, and just decided that, you know, I would do whatever I wanted. And I found myself in a real trap, you know. I mean, one of the things which has helped me tremendously is, you know, sort of remembering what good things I've done, you know, what nice things have happened to me. You know, and I forgot that for a while. You know, when it all started to go sour, I forgot, like, you know, what it was like in Australia, you know, what a nice time I had in Japan. And when I started to remember all that, you know, sort of come back to it, that really helped, you know, me tremendously. And also the kids, you know, the fans that sort of disappeared, all suddenly came back, you know, and showed their support.
Next week, Boy George talks about AIDS. Well, they used to do silly things with Wham, and now they're out on their own at the top of